deposited there. There will be a transfer of information. Based on that, the Indian company will make remittance to the Indian customer here. And this happens through a direct agent with the overseas company. Or there could be various sub-agents in the leg. So an agent in India will engage various sub-agents across India who will carry out this money transfer activity. So the issue arose before the tribunal as to what happens to sub-agents. For the agents, the argument was that the recipient was the person outside India, because my contract is with the recipient and therefore there is an export. But for the sub-agent, the contract is between the sub-agent and the Indian customer. And the Indian agent receives foreign currency from outside India and pays the sub-agent in Indian currency. So therefore, for the sub-agent, can it qualify as an export? That was an issue which arose before Paul mentioned. And the court ultimately read the terms of agreement with the overseas company. And they said the overseas company had stipulated in their contract that this sub-agent should be employed. And there was some restriction in terms of how the sub-agent can operate. And some infrastructure relating to this overall activity was provided to the sub-agents by the overseas company. So considering the overall facts, and there was also some determination in the agreement between the overseas company and the Indian agent as to what should be the commission which is payable to the sub-agent. So they looked at all these aspects and ultimately held that even a sub-agent, for a sub-agent it is an export in this context. So therefore, that principle can apply, but only difference here is that the obligation to make payment or the consideration in this case for the software is determined only between T&L US and India, and therefore the customer does not come anywhere in between in terms of determining the consideration. Therefore, I would still think that it's a rule 3 service and not rule 5. Practically, the larger issue which we are facing today is, since the Indian company, the project owner, has engaged the overseas company. The overseas company is going to bill the project owner in India for each of these services. So is there another reverse charge obligation for the project owner again on these services? We are saying that this is rule 5, therefore liable tax in India for the Indian company which provides. Again, can it be taxed under reverse charge basis for the project owner? That's the larger point of debate which is arising in the industry. Though that's not part of the question, but that's another issue which we can examine and support. So the third issue, I think that by and large the groups were in the consensus that the services between the Indian telecom company and the foreign telecom company, and therefore should not be liable to tax. I also explained the background of Vodafone, and therefore that's pretty clear. So, and the next question on SEZ. So this again, the groups had discussed the issue. The main issue is whether this is a process amounting to manufacture, and that the example itself somewhere states that it is a manufacturing service. Why I put that manufacturing services in a practical scenario where one of our clients had a similar fact pattern, where they were importing into India free of cost supply by overseas company, they were manufacturing and exporting back to them. We went to the SEZ authorities for approval as a manufacturing. The SEZ authorities will not give you approval as manufacturing. We said, no, it is manufactured under exchange law, it is manufactured under the SEZ law, it is defined, and therefore you should give us a manufacturing license. They said, no, we will not give you manufacturing. They said, we'll give you service license because the goods are not owned by you. It is supplied free of cost and you are exporting them. He said, how can we be a service provider? He said, no, you are a job worker and therefore it is a service under the law. The only issue which arises as a service in SEZ law is that if you are a service provider, then your earning should compulsorily be in foreign exchange. And therefore, that was one of the hitches which the customer had. And therefore, we wanted to classify under manufacturing, and ultimately we found in the SEZ law that there is a definition of manufacturing service itself. Not a definition, one of the categories is manufacturing service itself, which says that in these fact patterns where it is supplied free of cost and exported back to the same person or his agent, then it is a manufacturing service under law. So they gave us only a manufacturing service provider license under the SEZ law. So whether this is manufacture under excise law, it is manufacture. the activity is manufactured, but whether it is falling under this definition of process amounting to manufacture or production, that again, that definition is important, where it somewhere suggests that it amounts to process of manufacture or production which is leviable to duty under section 3 of the Excise Act. And any manufacturer in an SEZ is not leviable to duty under section 3 of the Excise Act. And therefore, this will not fall under that negative risk entry of process amounting to manufacture or production. Strictly reading the law. So if that is so, if it does not amount to manufacture or production under that negative risk entry, then service definition is very wide. Anything which is not excluded, etc., is liable. And you cannot also take the argument to the sale of goods, because here it is a free of cost supply where you are converting it into a finished product and exporting it back. There is no sale of goods also involved in this transaction. And therefore the exposure arises under the service tax law as to whether this is a service. And if it is a service, will it be liable to tax? Because the recipient of this service is outside India, but still it can fall under Rule 4, which says that in respect of goods which are provided by the recipient of service, then Rule 4 will come into play. And therefore, if Rule 4 comes into play, then this service will, the place of provision of service will be India. And there is no exemption, exclusion, etc. for any services provided by an SEZ. Services provided to an SEZ is exempt under that notification 41/2012, which somebody discussed yesterday. But services provided by an SEZ, there is no exemption under the law. And therefore, this transaction, if interpreted in the manner which I have stated till now, will be liable to service. But I don't think, I have put this for the argument, but I don't think that's the intention of the legislation, that the all these transactions should be taxed, and therefore there could probably be some amendment which will come into play. So though technically the department can raise this issue, but I think we should be able to defend this and say that it's not liable. It will still fall under the broad genus of manufacture, and therefore it should not be liable to tax. In fact, in this context, I also looked at the proviso in the rule 4, which says that if you import goods into India temporarily for repairs and export back within a specific period, then it is not liable under Rule 4. But that is exclusive to repairs activity alone, and it will not cover this manufacturing activity. Therefore, manufacturing activity may still have this risk of exposure. And with the buy and sell model, instead of free of cost supply, if you buy the equipment and then export back the finished goods, then this issue will not arise, because it becomes more an activity of a manufacturer. It's easy to defend that it is a sale of goods, and sale of goods, there is an exclusion under the definition of service, and therefore that can come into. Fifth example on airports. Again, broadly there was consensus. The only issue which arose was with regard to the service between the Indian subcontractor and the Indian main contractor. What will happen to the subcontractor's service in India? Because the subcontractor to an Indian main contractor, that falls under Rule 8 and not Rule 4. If it is Rule 5, then it is not taxable. Since it is Rule 8, then what happens to the services provided by subcontractor? Will that be taxable or not? So one of the group's view was that the subcontractor is providing services in relation to an airport, and airport definition will include a foreign airport also. This is Doha Airport outside India. So the larger issue which arises is whether an airport which is defined under the Airport Authorities of India Act 1994, will it include a foreign airport also, or can it include only an Indian airport? If it can include a foreign airport also, then the exemption under that entry 14A comes into play. If it does not include a foreign airport, then that exemption is not available for the subcontractor directly. So we did some research, and we had taken a point of view from somebody that this airport will include only Indian airport. So though from a plain reading of this definition of airport under the law, under the Aircraft Act, it doesn't actually signify that it includes or not includes foreign, but we had taken a view from someone that it will include only the Indian airports and it cannot include a foreign airport. Going by that, if it does not include a foreign airport, then this exemption under 14A will not be eligible for a subcontractor. Again, so assuming it includes, whether a subcontractor can claim that exemption directly under 14A, because 14A is a, the exemption which is provided for services by way of construction, erection, commissioning of equipment of original works pertaining to airport. So we need to see whether it is original works. If you go into the definition of original works includes erection, commissioning, installation of plant. Therefore, the subcontractor activity, which is erection, commissioning, installation of plant, will qualify as original works. And this entry as peculiarly has this word pertaining to. Many of the exemption entries, if you see, they don't have this word pertaining to. But this entry has words pertaining to airport. And since it says pertaining to airport, then it is bit broad enough to say that a subcontractor can also directly qualify under this entry. Erection, commissioning, installation pertaining to an airport will qualify for the subcontractor. If airport is exempt, if airport is not exempt directly, for subcontractor to the main contractor, then the issue which we have to look at is that a works contract or a pure labor contract? So I am assuming for a moment that it is a works contract. If it is a works contract, for a subcontractor, there is a exemption under section entry 29H, where if the subcontractor is a works contractor, and if the main contractor is also a works contractor, and if the main contract is exempt, then the subcontractor is also exempt. But in this scenario, the main contract is not exempt because it is not falling under Rule 14A. It is not exempt, but it is non-taxable. The contract between the main contractor and the overseas customer for a foreign airport is not exempt, but it is non-taxable. So in a non-taxable transaction, can the subcontractor still claim that exemption? So that seems to be difficult for me, because it specifically says that main contract should be exempt, only then subcontractor will be exempt. And will this transaction be treated as exempt or non-taxable? That becomes a larger issue of debate, and I think it's difficult for the subcontractor to get this exemption if the airport, foreign airport, does not qualify as an airport within the meaning of the Aircraft Act. There is another activity between the project office and the Indian company which can happen, because they have a project office outside India. So this issue of whether remittance of funds to project office is liable. So there again we have two points of defense here. One is to say that it is anyway under Rule 5. Even if the project office is providing service to the Indian company, it can still qualify under Rule 5 only, therefore it will not be taxed. Even otherwise, based on the relations of imposes and others, we can say that there is no service activity between the project office and the Indian company. Getting into question 6, a lot of confusion was there even in my mind when I discussed, so facts probably has not come out very clearly, but one of the assumptions which I had made is that there is no further consideration which is going for Thakur's of, for the Thakur's, there is one consideration which is paid in advance in lump sum by Dora Construction. Subsequently, when Dora Constructions is going to sell or lease these properties to the customer, then there could be a consideration which Dora Constructions received, but there is nothing which will flow to Thakur's at that point in time. So for Thakur's, the only consideration which will flow is on that agreement when they transfer the development right. That is the only consideration which flows. So the view predominantly has been that this is a service which has been completed prior to 30th 2012, and transfer of development rights is something which is related to a removal property, and therefore there will not be liable to service tax. That has been the broad view. So though we have examined this in the context, and many of the real estate laws have defined removal property to include any benefits which are accruing or arising in a removal property, and therefore many of the companies are taking a view that development rights are benefits accruing, arising, etc. Therefore, it will also be in a removal property and therefore not liable. The other issue which I wanted to debate is, assuming they have taken an opinion that it is not taxable, but assuming for a minute that it is taxable, when is the service completed by TAPOs when they enter into an agreement for transfer of the development, right? Is the right or the, is the service completed on the transfer entirely on the date of agreement, or since they have to subsequently do some component of the activity which is signing the lease deed or signing the sales deed, etc., is the service continuing even to the period after 36? And if after 36 it becomes flexible, then is there a portion of the service which still continues or after 36, and is there an exposure to service tax because of that service continuing after 36? So that is one which arose, because the example also does not talk about any invoice being issued. Service is completed, consideration is received, invoice is not issued, but the service becomes taxable from 1/7. So which can authorities say that Rule 5 will apply? Rule 5 of the POTR. So if we look at Rule 5 of POTR. I'm sorry, I'm not able to project this before you. Rule 5 of POTR talks about payment of tax in the case of new services. New services means services which are not taxable earlier but became taxable. So what is the requirement for payment of tax in the case of new services? So it says, where a service is taxed for the first time, then no tax shall be payable to the extent invoice has been issued and payment has been received before the service became taxable, and no tax shall be payable if the payment has been received and invoice has been issued within 14 days. So in our fact pattern, invoice has not been issued at all. In a case where no invoice is issued at all, I would take an argument that it is not taxable because the service was performed when it was not a taxable activity. Consideration was also received earlier. Invoice has also not been issued. So why should there be a tax at all? How can the authorities raise an issue now? Because it became taxable from 1/7. That we can raise. But if he issues an invoice for any reason after July, because the Dola Constructions insists that you have not issued an invoice for that activity at all. We only have an agreement, so give me an invoice. And assuming for a minute that he issues an invoice after July 1, then can there be a tax on this activity? Because the invoice is issued after July 1, service has been performed already, but this is a new service. So can Rule 5 apply and can the authorities say that you have tax? We had a practical scenario where there was a subsequent flow of consideration also to TAPOs from the subsequent leasing. So there was a consideration flowing later. So when will Rule 5 come into play? So that was the broader issue which we examined, and we thought, we also opined, that the basic principle for taxing a service, you should look at whether the service is taxable at the time of provision of service. At the time of provision of service or completion of service, if the service is not at all taxable, then merely because Rule 5 talks about invoicing or receipt, etc., that should not be a criteria for determining the taxability of service. Though the point of taxation is determined as to when you should determine the point of liability, ultimately, when the service was provided at a time when it was a non-taxable transaction, then merely because you issue invoice later, or merely because you receive consideration later, you should not be liable to tax. And Rule 5, if you see significantly a departure from the other rules, all other rules talk about determination of point of taxation. But Rule 5 doesn't talk about determination of point of taxation. It talks about payment of tax in case of new services. And it lays down in a negative language as to when a service, when no tax shall be payable. So therefore, Rule 5 cannot be read as an independent rule to determine a point of taxation. And therefore, going by larger principles, if a service is performed at a time when it was not taxable at all, you cannot, by invoking Rule 5, say that it will be taxable subsequently because invoice is issued or consideration is received. A transaction by Dola to customer, I think I mean, that's only a question, but by and large, it has been that residential construction should be based on continuous supply, and if it is leasing, it should be based on invoice or payment as the case. Getting into question number 7. So the main issue which, you know, all the groups have said that this Rule 8 which will apply because it is specific to copyright, and therefore since there is no invoice issued in this case, the date of payment should be given in the case of the original amount and no invoice is issued. For the supplementary invoice, the view was that the supplementary invoice amount. So the issue which I had in mind was, when is the service performed in this case? So the agreement, there was an MOU initially, and then there is a right which has been transferred in July 2013. But the consideration arises as and when there is a view subsequently. Therefore, is the service performed for the 20 years and the copyright is transferred? Is the service performed on the date of signing the agreement? Or is it performed continuously as and when it goes through the entire period of 20 years? Can we say that there is a continuous provision of service over the period of 20 years? Or has the performance of service terminated on entering into the agreement at the time of agreement? So that is the issue which comes in. Because if I get into Rule 8, of the BOTR. I'm reading Rule 8. In respect of royalties and payments pertaining to copyrights, trademark, designs and patents, where the whole amount of the consideration for the provision of service is not ascertainable at the time when the service was performed. So it says it should not be ascertainable at the time when the service was performed. Only then this rule can apply. So therefore the issue arises as to determining when the service is performed. Is the service performed on signing the agreement itself? Or is the service performed as a continuous service over the period of 20 years? If the position is taken that it is as and when it is performed, then Rule 8 may not operate. Because subsequently when you finally arrive at a consideration of 50 per view, at that point in time, you are able to determine the consideration, and thereafter whatever happens is a continuous supply, and therefore Rule 3 can operate for those services. So that is one point of view which comes into play, that if it is a continuous supply, if it is a continuous activity which happens over the period of 20 years, then it can still fall under Rule 3. That is one. And secondly, if it falls under Rule 3, then when should the tax apply? If it falls under Rule 3, then it is completion of service or invoicing or receipt. In this case, when is the service completed? Again, should we take it that if it is a monthly billing, then monthly service is completed? Or since they are going to pay quarterly, it is going to be a completion of service quarterly. So, I think the important factor in a service tax context is as to what is the completion of service and when the service is completed. So that has to be preferably as much as possible defined in the contractual arrangement between the parties as to when the service is completed. Unless that comes out in the contractual arrangement, it's going to be very difficult for us to substantiate before the authorities. And I mean, it's again subject to differing interpretations. And this also arise in the context of the other example of construction where we discussed what is the date, whether it is May or July. So there again, the whether when the completion is the service is completed, that will become a very crucial aspect. The authorities have raised an issue here saying that you have to pay service tax in July itself because the service has been performed then. Because we are applying Rule 8, saying that service has been performed already and therefore it is not assertable. And that is why we are getting into Rule 8. So the department is also getting into Rule 3 and saying that service is performed already, but I am going to go by the evaluation reports, etc., and I am not going to get into Rule 8. The argument of the department is that Rule 8 is not a non, does not start with a non-obstantive clause. If you see Rule 7, sorry, if I go to Rule 4, Rule 4 says notwithstanding anything contained in Rule 3. When I go into Rule 7, it says notwithstanding anything contained in Rule 3, 4, and 8. When I go to Rule 8, it says in respect of royalties. It doesn't start with a non-obstantive clause. And therefore, the service authorities are saying that I am going to invoke Rule 3 only. I will not get into Rule 8. And unlike the place of provision of service rules, which says that if there is a conflict, you go to the later rule. Here, there is nothing in these rules to say that you have to go to the later rule. So, authorities are saying that there is no non-obstantive clause, therefore, I will not apply this. For that, my point of defense is, if you read Rule 3, Rule 3 states, for the purpose of these rules, unless otherwise provided, for the purpose of these rules, unless otherwise provided, point of taxation should be. So, since it states that unless otherwise provided, Rule 3 will apply, and where there is a specific provision in Rule 8 to deal with cases of royalties, etc., therefore, we should still be able to argue saying that Rule 8 is the specific rule that has been specifically provided, and therefore, Rule 8 should only apply and not Rule 3. And if we apply Rule 8, then we can say that the consideration is determined only at the time of the performance of service. The consideration is not ascertained, it's ascertained only later, and therefore the things will follow.
About the right given for 20 years and
it's copyright. So the 3 points which arose us, one, whether it is goods or service, is that larger amount of debate still there because it's for a period of 20 years. So one of the groups came with a view, I mean again, I don't have any support for that, that if it is something beyond 10 years, then the Copyright Act itself prohibits some transfer. I'm not aware of that. Well, maybe they can relate to us, but that is one point of view which arose in the group, that it is beyond 10 years. And therefore, beyond 10 years, the law itself does not provide any transfer. And therefore, anything which happens is after 10 years. They are trying to differentiate the taxability between within 10 years and after 10 years. So, but I mean, to my knowledge, there is nothing prohibited in the copyright law to transfer beyond 10 years.
Any other questions?
Responding to the finish the analysis of 7.
That is on that, and the other point of the debate which arose was whether it can be treated as goods, because there is a transfer of right to use goods, and there are a lot of decisions in the trademark context that courts have held divergent views that it is liable to VAT or service tax, and therefore those principles can be borrowed to see whether it can be a transaction in goods and not a transaction in service. Again, the definition of service does not, whether it is a permanent transfer or temporary transfer, that can also come into point of interpretation at some point. In the context of leasing in direct tax laws, there is a Supreme Court decision that if it is the lease for a period beyond 20 years or above, then it's a lease in perpetuity. Therefore, going by that argument, can somebody say that if it is a 20-year copyright, it can guarantee the character of a permanent transfer? That is an independent thing which has to be examined. And here the issue, the invoice has not been issued. So there is a violation of Rule 4A. So one of the questions was, can the authorities compel that you should issue 4A invoice under the law? But I don't think the law has any provision for compelling to issue an invoice, though they can levy penalty for non-issuance of invoice, etc. But the authorities cannot compel you to issue.
I don't want to give a view, I just want to summarize what here generally, if you look at the faces, what they are expecting, they already discussed, they want the answer to each and every point in a logical sequence. Am I right?
Yes.
Some of you I can see are not satisfied that the analysis, unless you also want a conclusion. So first let me come to Mr. Vaithi Sharma. What you are saying is that this is not service at all, it is goods. Subject to what? Subject to?
Subject to VAT.
That is the point of view. You are confused or it is still wide open?
No.
Wide open.
I will go with it.
You will go with what? That
goods.
It's good. So if it is good, then all other things are irrelevant. Now if it is services, I just want to know, because you know, we also try to understand, I was letting you know a secret. Many of these people may not have attended the group. They will come here directly, straight away promotion. They want direct answers. Going directly. So, you know, in the previous one, you assume something and then you assume the people in the groups and then whatever you are saying is in line with the groups, with all the three groups. But there will be a fourth fellow group who is not there in that group at all. So they still want your answer. Okay. See, I have been on the other side. So, what I just want to summarize this seven, your analysis and conclusion, nothing else. What do you want to say, sir, that this, assuming it's a copyright service, the first thing is that it is not ascertainable on 1st July, it is ascertainable on a continuous basis. That is what you have to say. Otherwise, by rule it will come. Okay? Am I right, sir? So first, what you want to say is that the question is, it is not ascertainable. It is ascertainable only on a continuous basis. So, one would say rule 8 will apply.
Rule 8 will apply
also. No, here, you are very happy that yesterday, the only rule 8 will apply. And if rule 8, let me just say, so some people understand what we discussed yesterday. The general thing, feeling was rule 8 would apply, those things become simple, invoice is not issued. So, on the date of receipt, that is POT. Am I right?
Yes.
That was the conclusion.
Yes.
Very simple. The same way supplementary, it only says required to issue an invoice. So we assume that invoice is not issued. Okay. And since invoice is not issued, it is again payment. But if invoice is issued, then rule 8 says invoice issued or payment, whichever is available. And we stuck to rule 8. Those who are attending the group, you agree with all this, no? Now, sir, from this, no, you are not put into also, there could be rule 3, you can go to rule 3, you say. Because you say that it is acceptable.
That's what you want to say.
Another person.
I would suggest that rule 8 will apply.
Okay, fine.
Only in a case where it is not acceptable when the service is performed.
Okay.
So the issue arises as to when this service is performed. Is it performed on signing the agreement itself?
Yeah.
Or is this performed over the period of 20 years when the actual copyright transfer is given?
So what is your view, sir?
I would think that it is over the period of 20 years.
So on 1st July 2003, it is not performed. So that is out. It is performed on a regular basis. But you say, is it acceptable or not acceptable?
It is acceptable. So it is not relevant in the sense that at the time of performance, if it is a continuous performance, then when I actually perform this 50 per view, gets ascertained.
Yeah.
And therefore, from that point in time, rule 3 only will operate.
So rule 8 will not operate.
Right.
So let's all erase, you know, all of us are under the impression rule 8 will apply. Since he has concluded that it is a continuous supply, at every time that 50 rupees, what is it, have I right?
Yeah,
50 rupees. So you forget about rule 8 because at the point in which you are giving the continuous supply is ascertainable. So you have to go to rule 8, rule 3. And rule 3, then you have to go, if you go to rule 3, it says invoice or money, whichever is earlier.
Or date of completion.
Or date of completion. One by one. Slowly, sir. So invoice or payment, whichever is earlier. You have not issued the invoice. So then it says completion. If it is completion, what is completion of continuous supply? It is the event obligating payment. An event which should have happened, which obliges you to make payment. In this case, the end of the quarter.
You.
Am
for it. Is it end of the quarter?
Yes.
Continuous surplus. So that quarter is the event which is obligated payment. Okay. So it will be, I don't know, so far okay, no? So event obligating payment, that or payment, money received, whichever is earlier, is a point of tax. Is it correct?
Only thing is that
I'm trying to conclude.
Yeah.
Because they won't answer. Otherwise they'll trouble you afterwards.
Sir,
803 answer will come same, sir. 803 answer will come same in this case. I don't agree with you.
No,
no, no. Yeah. Yes. Now, let's get this. We want actually, I am not giving my view.
Yeah.
I mean, giving his view. In the language in which you want.
Sir, does it mean that I was not clear?
No, it is not that. Our audience is not. So we are first, sir, you are saying rule 8 will not apply because all of them are under the impression rule 8 will apply. Rule 3 will apply because you know, seen that one important thing that, to be very frank, I had never seen that. Not as a rule, this interpretation I never saw. So rule 3 will apply. If rule 3 will apply, we are not issued the invoice. So that end of the quarter is the event obligation.
There is one issue.
Please.
Because we are saying consideration was agreed to be paid on quarterly.
Yes.
But still we are not saying as to whether that is the event for completion. We have stated as a fact that it is agreed, consideration is agreed to be paid.
Hmm.
So the completion of the event, I think we still have to define something.
So when?
It is not defined here. So I think that has to be defined in the contract as to when.
So
can it be?
I think it's very important. By looking at the definition of continuous supply, just a minute, anybody, see, as it is, this, we are short of time. Excuse me, sir. You are forming a sixth group now. We need to do a group. Please, we are not having time. Let's move this. I only want conclusion for everybody's benefit. One second. What I want to say is continuous supply definition is an event obligating payment. That is what it says.
Yes.
If you are able to find out that event is obligated payment, that is the point of taxation. Correct?
Right.
Why you are not able to find out this?
Because event is obligating payment, one can be...
Because once it is quarterly basis. Once the quarter is over, I have given the service, that is the event in which I have payment is the... You have the right to ask for payment.
So that is the date on which consideration was agreed to be paid.
Maybe paid later on, but that is the date in which you have the right to receive the payment. That is all continuous supply to your case. On that day, you have the right to receive. But when you receive your contract, that is why if the right is 60 days, you will have to but issue the invoice within 30 days of that. And the BOT will be there. It will not be 60 days. Sir, you have a different. Yes, sir.
Sir, rule.
Can we discuss? See, can we discuss later?
Yes.
I have just if I am able to convince him, and we are able to give the view, we are losing time. Yes.
Sir, rule 8 says that we are the whole of the amount of the consideration.
We are not on rule 8 because on rule 8 his view is rule 3 is the amount.
So
forget it. Please. Sorry for that. So I am only trying to see. I am not going to give you my view. I am only trying to give you this view so I can conclude.
Okay.
Ultimately, you want to know when I have to pay tax, no? That is very important. Okay, so, Mr. Sira, only I want to tell you this. Do you agree that at the end of the quarter, the event obligation payment was arrived? That is the point of taxation. And all the payment is easy earlier. So, rule 3, first rule 3 and this. Next. Excuse me. I hope at least whatever I have concluded, you are able to give some direction when to pay the tax. I hope all of you are able.
So rule 8 again on this construction, there was...
I just want to tell you the general... Many of the people, those who are not attended, are also mixed. And some of the group leaders who are not practicing service tax. So ultimately what they want is, knowing them for so many years, ultimately you have to give them the final conclusion when they have to pay tax.
Mm-hmm.
What is the point? Please. No, that is the most important.
So I'm questioning, then one of the group had all the answers, said all the dates are possible, we have 15
which is no answer.
But the other two groups mainly said 15th July is the date, because that's the date when the work was certified, and circular 1.4 of 2011 was referred. That it also provides for some such contingency. And tax is payable on 85%, that's the government view. Retention is also taxable, that's what was said. And I'm just stating the groups you said.
Afterwards, your view.
So, reverse charge will apply. The other implications is since services by LLP, reverse charge will apply. And SILVAT on retention money will be an issue because the money has not been paid. It's the broad situation. So, the primary thing is whether the running account bill is an invoice. That's the main issue which is to be looked at. If you strictly look at the language in the service tax rule, it says invoice, bill, or chalan as the case may be. So, therefore, even if you call it a bill or anything, as long as it has all the contents of an invoice, it still can be considered as an invoice. And therefore, I would tend to think that a running account bill is also an invoice under the service tax law. And when you go to the point of taxation, since the services has been completed on May 31, and no invoice has been issued within 30 days, then the service may be taxable on May 31st itself. Because service has been completed, invoice has not been issued within 30 days, and it's a continuous supply again, like Mr. Krishnan said, it's the event which requires the recipient to make payment, etc. Therefore, the date will be May 31. And 144 circular, I mean, though it may apply, there is somewhere in the circular I read that the circular is issued for enabling the service provider to issue an invoice. But here the invoice is issued, whether right or wrong. He has issued the invoice. And the 144 circular is for enabling somebody to issue an invoice at a later point in time. The invoice having been issued, I would tend to think that the date of point of taxation is only May 31st and not a subsequent event. You could have planned it in such a manner to say that it is a statement of work, not an invoice, whatever, but on the facts, it's a bill, and therefore it's an invoice under the law. Retention money is taxable since the work has been certified as completed, and therefore completion of services happened. So even if there is retaining a part of money, according to me, retention money is also taxable.